Welcome to a rebroadcast of my show, Sophia's Emporium, that was originally aired on June 6, 2016. Now, maybe some of you know me by now. My name is Suz Pratt, and I love the art of life charting. I really enjoy getting to know people on a deep personal level, and this is the way that I came to know myself on a deep personal level. So when this show was originally broadcast, Randy and I had already known each other for a moment. Randy Moggins interviewed me back in December of 2015. And so now it's my turn to bring him on the show and interview Randy. And of course, most of you people out here in the anti-media group know Randy. He's an incredible man. And so he graced me with opening up and talking about his journey. So I hope you enjoy this. I'm going to go ahead and share the screen. And now, surely, we're going to start this show. And we were both associated with CCN at this time, so ignore all that part.
Hi, friends. Once upon a time, wise ones in the NeverEnding Story knew science and spirituality were a united force which could not be divided. Like the lover and the beloved, when the church and state allegedly divided long ago, these two subjects were ripped apart, bastardized, and forced into a divorce that would torment the children of the kingdom.
Really? What do we have
here on Conscious Consumers Network?
We're
here to create a sacred space, one where we can reverse the irreversible, bring light and normalcy to the paranormal, and to fulfill our individualized dharma, which brings us home to the Alpha and the Omega, like the one and the O or the zero, however you want to look at it. Today is a homecoming for me, if you will. Back in December of 2015, I did two shows on life charting with Randy Moggins, host of Off Planet Radio and the Threshing Floor TV. And now today, on June 4th in the year 2016, it is my distinct pleasure and privilege to interview Randy. Recently, Randy coined a phrase, and it's called anti-media, and I dig it. So today, we're going to merge our consciousnesses and our timelines in an effort to reveal our deeper relationship. And the reason why this is important to y'all is because in the end, as you know, we're all one whether we like it or not. So with that all being said, I'd like to introduce y'all to my other mother, because Randy feels like he gave birth to me. So I'm also going to call him my cosmic brother. We're spiritual family. Hi, Randy.
Hi, Suz. Thanks for having me on. Yeah, we're twin brothers from other mothers, aren't we?
Something like that, exactly.
Yin and yang, we mix it, you know, the cosmic hermaphrodite. Yeah, I gave birth to you.
You really did.
This was an experience of, you know, in a lot of ways. I said to you a while back, when I looked at what you were doing with your TV show, I was kind of beaming like a proud daddy, because that was always the goal, was to replicate. It is about spinning off from ourselves creative sparks, inspiring other people, and creating this universe where others can create and we can kind of bang off of each other and create this distortion field that goes out into the metaverses and creates an entirely new reality.
Amen, brother. So, you know, the last couple days, I spent a lot of time watching Brooks Agnew, and I know that you interviewed him. Did you say that was back in 2009, I believe?
Yeah, it was actually back in the days when Off Planet Radio was still called Exotica. We were actually running that show on shortwave radio. And I interviewed Brooks Agnew about the two Earths in 2012 and the Ark of Million Years, which is a series of books that he did cosmically. Interestingly enough, the books were written in the future and then transmitted back to the year 2007, where they were published. So how's that for bending time?
Well, actually, that is one of the two videos that I watched. And so, of course, part of what we're going to do today is merge our timelines. Mm-hmm. So in regard to, I believe it's Dr. Agnew, right, putting him in his professional spot there. He knew of it just like how Steiner knew of it as in regard to the moon, because this happened. I know there's really no time in all this, but in what we call our past. So maybe what we're doing now with Bruce's information is to bring it into the present to help all of our friends and family understand the potentials that could arise as we go through this ascension process.
Yeah, absolutely. By the way, this is the book. I hope that shows up on screen there. That's volume one of three books. You can see it's a pretty substantial book. Let's see, that's the second volume right there.
Lovely.
And then volume three. I mean, we're talking massive, massive books here. The three volumes together are very thick. Don't get intimidated by that. The books are written to be understood. And what they really are is the research compilations that Dr. Agnew and his co-author, whose name is E.J. Clark, put together. And the purpose of the books was really to create a template for the ascension process. Now, I would say that at the time of the writing and the time of publishing these books, which was pre-2012, we were looking at 2012 as kind of an ascension point. But I saw 2012 more as a transition into what was a longer arc. And it's very interesting that Dr. Agnew writes in the book basically establishing something that we need to understand. The energy pattern of each individual human conscious person on the planet is itself an energetic wave that goes out. So when we talk about times and dates and timelines and we try to fix dates, what we're really doing is we're omitting a critical factor about events that occur, because we are constantly creating. We are constantly throwing off our own energetic format, our own consciousness, into this ethereal stream that moves constantly. So the 2012 thing is kind of a misdirect in a way. And I think any date that we attempt to establish is kind of a misdirect, because what we don't take into factor here is that we have the ability to create in the moment both past and future events. And yes, I did say past as well, because I think for many of us, we are recreating ourselves. We're going back and forth in the future in these temporal bodies that we have, and we are moving around the building blocks of creation to future timelines. That sounds really spacey. but it's actually part of a greater cosmological understanding that goes into the depths of these books and many other writers as well.
I think it's beautiful because it reminds me of what we're going through as spiritual human beings. Mm-hmm. We believe that our physicality is so important, where it's really more of a shadow or a shell, in the same regard as, say, what theoretically happened with the moon. When the division took place, one was a higher vibrational planet, and surely the people that resonate like that would choose to go there and have no fear. The other place that is a shell is more one where, I guess, maybe greed and mining and materialism and more of a 3D reality are going on, which is a beautiful thing for the people that only know that or are so traumatized by our collective past that they still can't let go.
Yeah, a lot of what we're talking about here is basically healing the collective. Yes. And the collective, anybody that's ever worked in certain types of therapy, inner child healing is a big one. Some of the things that we're going to talk about today in terms of life charting, journaling, and things like that, and some of the images that I'm going to share today are attempts by humans to heal the future by healing the past.
Yes.
A lot of what I've dealt with for the last, well, let's see, 2009, last 7 years in doing my present show has been the subject of trauma, largely the trauma of people who have gone through traumatic early life events in terms of abductions, UFO ET encounters, government black ops projects such as MKUltra, and satanic ritual abuse as well. And those are scars in the collective consciousness of humanity. Each person who has pain inflicted upon them willfully by another being suffers a very deep traumatic tear. That is not contained just within the vessel of that human being. It is also part of the collective unconscious, and it is part of the psychopathic disruption that has gone on in the psyche of humanity for thousands and thousands of years that we know of, and probably longer. And so a lot of what we're talking about here is inner work manifesting as outer creation in order to heal the generations. Interesting point here, Suz. As you know, I did the show called The Threshing Floor. That show ran from 2003 to around, kind of tended to terminate at around 2011. And that show focused a lot on the study of the languages within the scriptures of the Holy Bible. One of the words that I spent a lot of time deciphering in the book was actually the word that was translated as generations in the Old Testament. What I discovered when I went through the etymological roots of that word in the Hebrew was at some point it resolved to a constant stream back and forth between generations, both past and future. Hence, that the concept of redemption, which is not understood by religious people, that concept of redemption had to do with healing the past in order to bring redemption forward to future generations. So when I'm talking about these concepts, they sound abstract, but they are in fact what was part of an intention by, we will say, Source to enable humanity to be healed of trauma and to move forward into a future where we no longer were spinning off all of these conscience-altering traumatic events.
And to me, this seems completely normal since I've lived it my whole life. I know that when I spent time with you in December, I truly wasn't as expanded as what I am now concerning that truth in my generations and my lineage. And we will get to explore that today. But, you know, really right now, what I'm more focused on just for the moment is a conversation on how two people like us could come together and be close and explain to people that this goes way beyond this time and space.
Well, you and I encountered each other, as I recall, on Facebook, and somehow began a conversation, a dialogue. You were kind of watching what I was doing.
I was watching your shows, absolutely.
Right, yeah. And you kind of made it clear at the time that you were very much what we call in the jargon a newbie in terms of the internet, and that you sort of were in this process. And maybe you can explain a little bit about that, this process that you were going through of suddenly coming online and discovering all of these troves of information, sorting through all of this, a person who hadn't done this before, and basically initiating your own awakening in such a way that you were reaching out. You were reaching out proactively. This was not Suz going, hey, can you feed me some more information? Can you prove this? Can you send me a web link? It was Suz going, hey, Randy, I hear what you're saying. I'd like to explore this. And that quickly, you were moving in a very proactive direction towards us doing those two shows together, which that was a few months of dancing around, as you know. That wasn't a hasty decision. We just, boom, one day decided, hey, let's do this. And then from there, very quickly, you grabbing the reins and going, I'm going to do this. I've never done this before. I'm going to do this TV show on Conscious Consumer Network. And I'm like, that's friggin' awesome. Here's somebody that's barely been on the internet for 2 years, and she's stepping up to the plate, and she's not going to sit around anymore and wait for people to spoon feed her. She's actually going to go out there and do something. Now, how cool is that?
All right. Cool enough. But what I think is even cooler, do you know that you were my sixth YouTube subscriber 11 months ago?
So there you go. There you go.
I would even go branch out a little farther. There, in my mind, could be very little time or no time where we had a place to come together and know each other. It's like you were there before it happened.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah.
No time.
Yeah, no time. And see, let's talk about no time for a minute.
Okay.
People think, well, you're saying there's no time? I got a clock in front of me here, kind of is like elapsing. It's like 5:16 right now, and in like 30 seconds, it's going to flip to 5:17. So what are you saying? Well, what I'm saying is no time is time. It's time, no time, because time isn't as fixed as most people think it is. And this is where it gets trippy. You know, maybe somebody needs to go eat some mushrooms and go out in the desert for a while or something, or maybe not. But to understand no time, you need to understand that time is a dimension. It's funny because this just came up on Facebook today with Chris Holly. Time is a dimension, and that dimension is actually a time domain. It's part of the matrix. We're actually eternal creatures. We actually have been, always are, and as yet, but still are to be, and we are conscious creation in a nonlinear fashion. And observationally, you may not think that's true, but I think everybody has experienced no time, where time stands still, it speeds up, it slows down, and geez, I've watched it go backwards a couple of times. So the no time concept, it's difficult if you want to sit there and rationalize it in your head. The easiest way to grasp it is simply allow yourself to release the present moment in a state of no mind, no mind, no time, no conscious mind. The mind is always there.
What I also think is interesting, and this just comes from a perspective of our two mentors we're referring to, is that some people, since they are not active in their lives, now I don't mean physically running around and running amok, I'm talking about active inner lives. So if they don't do much with this time, to them it seems to go by very fast. Where someone that resonates like us, that does an incredible amount and multitasks,
yeah,
these are the privileged people that time can slow down for. That's why, like, say, one of the things my clients just mimic is about how fast their time goes, and they don't know where their time is.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that is one of the major relevant reasons why we should life chart if we wonder where our time is going. Because if we start to look at all the stories that take place, then all of a sudden, I mean, we really are eternal. I mean, that's what I've enjoyed about the life charting the most. And there's been so many things that I can take into my being now, and they just extend right out and don't bother me, things that would traumatize most people. So, you know, I'm a victim of trauma, and we've discussed that a little bit.
Yep.
But one thing that I always said, and I don't know if it was because I was involved in the program at the time, or because it is an essential part of my being. But I would always say to people, I was never abused, molested, or tortured. And even though that's true, I do want people to realize that they can be tortured even if it doesn't fit into a standardized category like that. I have something that I'd like to read and share when we're discussing our relationship, you know. So Steiner says, the soul lives on because in its hidden depths, there are forces able to hold fast in memory what has been experienced. The immortal means having the power to preserve in memory the renounced past experience. That is the real definition of human immortality. Goes on to say, the human being is of such a nature that he bears his own being through future ages by the force of supersensible memory. And then we'll finish that one up with, then you will feel what a monad is. That is a self-enclosed being, a being carrying itself. It is only through the experience of initiation that one can arrive at such conception.
So what he's saying there basically is we are a universe within ourselves. If I'm following what he said completely, the idea of the monad is basically a completeness within oneself and yet not excluding others.
Right. And then we see the bubbles that overlap.
The bubbles. Yeah.
Yes, yes. And that's, even if there's people that we would hope to never be one with, that now we can see the importance of that. And I think we might see that on our little trip down the life charts today.
Well, you know, that's an interesting concept, and it's something I'm dealing with right now. In terms of, let's just say, people that we don't want to associate with, people who are, let's say, dark side or negatives, we exclude them from any future reality because of the negativity. But what we're talking about in this process is basically, again, the healing. And that healing, which would occur in the past future, the past which is to be healed, is actually the effort of the awakened one to then go forward and create the completion of the other, which has been excluded by that unhealed trauma. So in effect, again, we are affecting healing within the human arc in order to create that completion process so that there is no longer separation, this concept of others. You know, we live in a duality. We are in a constant stream of black and white, yin and yang, good and evil, da-da-da-da. But ultimately, we resolve to a state of oneness and completeness that does not any longer exclude the others, but brings them back into the collective. Very difficult concept when you're dealing with duality and you're dealing with human beings who are very polarized, which we are. So ultimately, you know, again, what we're talking about is we begin the healing within ourselves. We create the healing circle by bringing others in and encouraging that healing both within and without the beings.
It's a wonderful reality, and I feel so blessed to have had so much experience in the subject, and I know you have too, that we can witness to the truth of this. Right.
Yeah.
So I'd like to go through your life chart now, if you're ready to do that. Would you like to begin?
Yeah, I'm not sure I know how to begin. I know you and I talked about this a little bit in terms of how we want to do this. As I said, I've never formally life charted. What I have done is I've kept journals, and that is a form of, I guess, life charting as well.
Well, let's start where we should start. What would you say your temperament was as a child? And this would be, say, before the age of 7. Let's look there.
Wow, that's a big question. My temperament. I've always been moody, introverted, but not withdrawn. In other words, most people don't understand what an introvert is. An introvert is somebody who lives inside themselves, but they are not necessarily withdrawn. So while I lived in a world that was largely my own, I was probably very shy, and I was probably kind of walking wounded a lot of the times when I was small, but I was also outgoing in the sense that I liked people, and I liked to engage the creative process that was around me. I did a lot of art. I mean, I learned to read when I was about 4.5 years old. My mother taught me to read really early in life. So I read from the time I was 5 years old, which was such a gift to be able to experience the world that way.
Do you remember the early grade school reading test where they would rate you and you were at a 12 plus reading level already?
Well, part of the backstory to all of this has to do with what is called IQ or intelligence quotient and how that's scored. And I don't say this with pride at all. My own IQ was somewhere around, I think they said 170 at the time when I entered school. Grade school testing, whatever that means. I mean, look, it's a number. Somebody made it up. It's on a chart. It doesn't really mean a lot to me. What it meant was that I was perceptive, and it meant that I was teachable, and it meant that, you know, there was processes going on in the brain. So that's as far as I usually take it with that. But yeah, I had an advanced reading level.
Can I ask a more personal question now?
Sure.
Okay. As I've discovered a lot about MKUltra and the different programs that were ongoing, would you say that it's a probability that maybe you were one of those brilliant kids that were isolated to have other tests and other experiences, or did you not experience any of that?
Yeah, there's that. I think one of the things that I discovered years ago, and it's part of the thing that propelled me to do this show and for the last 7 years, was the curiosity behind that. There was definitely extraneous testing that was done, and I distinctly remember it. And I also distinctly remember being taken places as a kid that didn't make sense later. And some of those memories, you know, they're kind of fragmented, they're distorted, but I distinctly remember some of the tests, and I just distinctly remember interacting with people who don't fit into the nice, tidy little universe that I seem to live in growing up in a small town of 3,000 people, and some of the experiences. So yeah, I've reached that conclusion, and that was a conversation that I've had with a number of people over the years as I got to know people who came out of projects and people who suspected they were part of projects. And that's not unimportant, because I think what we've discovered is that MKUltra is kind of an umbrella, but what was more important was Project Talent. And Project Talent operated from the late 1950s, as best I can tell. It operated on the record effectively through the 1980s, although I don't believe it's ever gone away. I don't think any of these programs go away. And I believe that they were using the databases that they had, were compiling even before World War II, because they were compiling extensive records at that time. I think they were using those records and merging them with the records of people who served in military. They were using public birth records. They were also monitoring at that time blood types, genotypes, and some very advanced concepts that you wouldn't think would have been true in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. So they were already profiling. Moreover, what I've discovered is that profiling was being done pre-incarnationally.
Yes.
And there's a couple of my shows out there where I've talked about this, the fact that we were profiled as souls before we came in. And that explains a lot of why certain people wound up being targeted coming into this earth plane and wound up being even in so-called Illuminati families, or families with bloodlines, or families that had some sort of occult connections, all of which, you know, to some degree or another, I had present in my own past. So were there interactions with Black Ops projects? I have every reason to think so at this point. Was I part of those programs? Was I used? I tend to not think so much that, as like many thousands and maybe even hundreds of thousands of people, we were profiled, we were tested, we were taken to facilities, and they attempted to see what they could use us for. We were raw human material for the New World Order.
Right, and I think that that's exactly why I had the traumas that I did when I was young. So if I go back in my own story, there was about a 2-year period where I have very little memories after I had second and third degree burns on the right side of my,
yes,
my forehead here. But, you know, the memories of, say, running away from a cab that was driving me to a German doctor to get shots, you know? Mm-hmm. And I can only imagine what I knew as reality once I entered those doors, and I would always be under a table, you know? I mean, literally. So the more that I look at it, I really do realize that, I mean, what, maybe 50% of the population would have had some kind of a visitation of that, because so many people gave their lives and their service in the military, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you got to consider that they had a huge database compiled, certainly from World War II forward. Don't forget that IBM provided the computers to Hitler during World War II that he compiled his list from. That goes back to Watson, the founder of IBM. So even though we believe we now live in the computer era, the fact of the matter is that there were computers, they were compiling databases probably as early as the late 1930s.
And of course, they had the same technology to compile those databases back in Atlantean times.
Right. So
we surely did have a long gap, no doubt, and say, if we're imagining the Dark Ages and looking at the Renaissance and things like that, surely there was no forward knowledge of blood type. But say, for example, when you brought that up a few moments ago, it was 1937 when they rediscovered, you know, the ability to say if you are negative or positive and what family you're from.
Right.
And then it's so interesting because if you look at, say, what theoretically goes on in the royal bloodlines and things, they keep very tight grips, and then, you know, you see the reason for arranged marriages. Now, surely at that time, I don't believe that they could know the difference between positive and negative, and that's why so many of the royals actually did have birth defects and things and were shooed away to a...
That was the reason why that's why you had inbreeding was largely because at that time they did not understand that. But what they knew was that by continuing to breed within family bloodlines themselves, they were retaining certain genetic components, even if they didn't have that language for it at that time. They understood it. The truth of the matter is genetics has been with us for tens of thousands of years. There's this little book that opens, you might have heard of it, it's called the Bible, it's called Genesis. Well, the word Genesis means genetics. And if you look at that book, it's got detailed records in the Book of Numbers that detail a lot of these bloodlines. You know, the Book of Matthew in the New Testament opens with the bloodline genetics of Jesus Christ. So, you know, I tend to think this is old science. This has been preserved, and that the so-called Illuminati have always had this ability on some level, whether they've called it Rh negative factor, whether they've called it genetic profiling or whatever. A lot of this is ancient science that was well understood, you know, in civilizations long ago and far away on planet Earth.
I think that one of the hardest things as we open up this can of worms on blood type is just like we see prejudice now in the different colors of people across Mother Earth, that when you get down the blood type rabbit hole, and we'll leave the negative and positive out momentarily, but the actual letter itself has a probability of denoting who messed with your DNA. So whether it was fallen angels or whether it was off planet, different groups of life forms, or even, you know, I hate to say it like this, I really do, but more of a reptilian animal brain that instead of ascending up, goes the way, vegetable man. And I think a lot of people are controlled by it. Now, what we're doing by bringing these things up, as you know, is releasing them. So for our viewers, I just like to bring up that you and I both know our blood types and that you are an AB, which is the absolute most rare. They even call it mutative in a sense that you can't get any fix on it. And then, of course, and then of course, I'm an A, so we're both negative blood, and we also have an idea of what that means.
Well, I may be negative. That constitutes 0.6% of the population. It's the rarest blood type. And there's a whole lot of correlated data that goes into the AB negative, along with some other genetic traits as well, that are of interest to people, for instance, who are contactees or abductees of off-world entities. One of the studies was NICAR's study, which was published in, I want to say, 2005, could have been sooner than that, where they correlated a high level of reported ET abductions against this disproportionately tiny sliver of the population with AB negative blood. The numbers were so contrasting that you looked at them and you could reach no other conclusion that there was something of interest to off-world beings in terms of this rather rare blood type.
Now, the only thing that I can say to that, because I've not had an actual experience with this, is that it's said that you cannot mess with the negative blood type as easily. It's harder to implant. It's harder to get in there and move things around. We have some kind of a natural immunity. So do you know from your research in that if the ABs, whether they're negative or positive, if they tend to have more positive experiences, I mean not the kind that are traumatic and painful and surgical. They're more conversations and uploads and downloads and exchanges from where I've looked at it from.
No, I don't think anybody has data for that, mainly because in the world of ufology right now, we don't have good databases. The most dominant research groups out there, which for the most part here in the United States is MUFON, suck at keeping any kind of records. And in fact, they're derelict in having sold those records off and not maintaining good record keeping. I don't think we know that. The whole ET contact thing is, depending on who you talk to, there's a huge amount of trauma involved with it, no matter what.
Right.
A positive contact initiated when somebody has no concept of off-world entities is very traumatic. An abduction, obviously, you know, is very traumatic. There's long-term components to it. You know, my own contacts began when I was 3 years old. I do not think they were traumatic. I think they were positive entities. I distinctly have memories of this. And I think those went on for a long time. I think they were preparation for something that was coming. I think they were benevolence. But what happened later was that they began to turn the corner into the other types of abductions that resulted in experiments and missing time, and very strange out-of-body experiences. And so I would say that most people who have extraterrestrial contact experiences probably have both on some level. Because again, I'll go back to what I said earlier. Pre-incarnational programming, or profiling, I'm sorry. Pre-incarnational profiling would have also yielded data as to who was of interest to both sides of this. We're in a game.
Oh, absolutely.
The Matrix game is being played, and we're playing it consensually, by the way.
Absolutely.
So, unfortunately, the difference between us and the cabal, the Illuminati, is we agreed to forget we were playing the game. They didn't. So on one level, the game we're playing blind while they're playing fully disclosed. And that's part of the battle that's going on right now with the truth movement. So I think people who were targeted both positively and negatively. And I think that's why you see this advanced movement in the UFO communities of people who I would say are a little more evolved in terms of pushing the envelope on the consciousness expansion.
I wanted to, real quick, share with you how they made first contact with me. But of course, in my mind, the way that I experienced it, is it gave me a peace of mind knowing that the people that slept downstairs that were my parents really weren't my parents. And so, of course, I looked at that like God wanted to kiss me on the forehead or one of those things. But here's what happened. So I've got my pointer made. I'll be easily able to touch base and show you. You see this cute little doll face woman right here in the middle of this picture? Right there.
Yeah, yeah, I see that now. Yeah.
Okay.
I just went to zoom my screen. Okay.
There you go. This was my Aunt Florence. And when I was 3 years old, her and my grand's brother, Uncle Hal, came for a visit, and they presented me with a blue, glow-in-the-dark figurine that resembles this angel that we see right here. Whether or not it was the Blessed Mother or an angel, it's hard to say, because shortly thereafter, someone came and grabbed it up and got it away from me. I didn't lose it. It was taken from me. Then these very same people, of course, were hip to what happened to me when I was burned. And so my last memory of them is they were in a heated debate at the fence with my parents. And that was shortly after I suffered my burn. So, you know, as far as my contact, I think I've been blessed in the sense that for all the years of nightmares, all there was darkness. There was never a fixed image. There was never a monster I could see. And so when I came out of my fear-based life around 38, it was like a healing happened, and I really didn't have that dream anymore. So however that all ties in, I think it's a great example to people. I hope they have the courage to face what they believe is their past and delve into it, that there's just a world of benefit. And I think the biggest benefit is going to be their eternal life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Right. I mean, it's interesting to use the term fear-based. Probably the most difficult trauma to cure is the essential fear-based responses that we have. They're valid on one level. You know, the psychology says it's fight or flight response, which is basically the reptilian brain that activates all these chemicals in our body that's self-preservation. What psychiatry certainly learned by the 1920s and what they advanced through the 20th century was how to harvest this. It was also something that these ancient gods, so-called, understood as well. That was the point of all these sacrificial situations where they were doing trauma-based ritual sacrifices, including the Baal worship that you see detailed in the Old Testament, where they were burning babies, human sacrifice, sacrifice of animals. Again, a brutal concept that continued through religions up until, you know, the beginning of the last millennium. So all of these fear responses have been hardwired into us, and they are the opposite of the thing that we need to develop, which is the love response.
Exactly.
The ability, you know, what does the scripture say? Again, it says, perfect love casts out all fear. Perfect love casts that out. Now, what is that? Well, it's the point where you begin to integrate into yourself the concept that you are eternal, that the most essential part of us lives in a core here and it can't be touched. No matter how traumatized or screwed up you are, there is a kernel there that can't be touched. And that's the part that people need to learn. And that's the part that the people on this planet need to learn, because we live in a planet that has been traumatized by monsters. When we heal ourselves, we begin to heal others. Ultimately, we're going to do the process that we talked about, because then we've got to go heal the monsters.
And like Steiner says, concerning monsters, if a monster comes up to you on the street, and it's ugly, and it's hideous, and it snarls.
Yeah, I've actually experienced that, too. It's amazing.
Confirmation of spirit, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. So if that image comes up and admits that it is that image, every bit of it, honest,
yeah,
then we must call it beautiful. And that's where the healing happens, because, you know, if from the beginning of when the cell divides off, that there was some purpose for that being to fulfill, it's done its job. Now, it wouldn't have any resonance with us because we don't vibrate like that. And I think now we're back to Dr. Agnew's beautiful illustration of these two Earths dividing off. And that both groups have their place, and both groups will evolve, but at different rates.
Yeah, that's it's a tough concept to grasp, the idea that we're going to split reality streams, that there are two worlds. There's the lower world and the upper world. And it's a concept I grappled with for a long time. I'm kind of like, well, what does that mean? Does that mean the Earth literally physically splits? Do we transition off of timeline somehow? Is there a dimensional shift? And I think we're in the process of a creation that leads us to that. And I think it will be so subtle that this is what's called the New Jerusalem, the Kingdom of Heaven, Paradise, you know, Nirvana, all of these terms, these metaphors that have come down through the ages. In forms of esoteric writings, is that we are in the process of creating something in time that transitions to something in no time. There we are again, back to no time.
Well, and also transitions in its purpose. It grows up, and back to the idea of time, we needed that perception to visualize our parts in it and to figure out why we believe what we believe, which leads us to our second question. So in the teenage years, and I know especially when we talk about the Bible, it seems more of a temptation of the seven deadly sins during those teenage years, you know, tempted with every naughty thing that you didn't do when you were a child. But they say that really what that time is about is asking yourself why you believe you believe. And that is like a primary initiation point for some people. It shatters them because they're so far in the box. All they can say is, because. Why did that happen? Because. So, what was your experience with that as a teenager? What did you question or say, why the hell do I believe that?
Well, you're a brutal questioner. That's tough. I think when we grow up with rules, we grow up with the rules that were given by our community, our families, our religions. And some of those rules resonate and some don't. I think for me, you know, there was always a core belief system that I've never deviated from a whole lot. And it largely has to do with dealing with good and evil on the perspective of what is best for the others. In other words, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. You know, the crimes that I consider to be actual sin, if you want to call it that, are crimes against another person or another person's property. And that includes that person, their spirit, their psyche, their body, and anything around them. And those are things you don't deviate from. Now, within the world of morals and dogma, oh, sorry, Albert Pike there, but we begin to test the rules. We begin to push the barriers a little bit. We're not, as we move out of being a child and moving into puberty, for instance, obviously, all the temptations of the emergence of the hormonal system, you know, these sudden differentiations between the child self and the parent self, the seeking of an independent identity, which means testing the presence that you have in the footprint of the social culture, that's like a perfect storm for rebellion. But the rebellion itself is ultimately just rebellion against the structures and redefining oneself in the context of who they are as a person.
Maybe that's why there are so many people that believe that the best time of their life was high school, because they were doing all those things that you said. They had a little bit of freedom, Randy, before they gave it up.
I found the whole culture of high school to be really oppressive. It was its own social drama. And, you know, that's, I will say that that institution, the educational institution, is a social structure that was designed for social engineering. You know, it had a pecking order, it had a social stratum, it had its own implicit rules. And to be quite honest with you, people could be very cruel in the incubator of these social institutions, just like the church. You know, you think church is there to breed good character and good values, and then you find out that the priest is messing around with the little altar boys, or you find out that, you know, somebody's up for somebody else's wife in the choir loft. I mean, these institutions that we live in are simply social incubators. I did not like them. I did not enjoy high school. I mean, I went there, I participated, you know, what are your choices? If I look back now, if I had it to do over again, I'm not nostalgic for that world much.
Me neither, Randy. No. I don't know if you, well, let me just tell you, because I know there's so much I go over in my shows, but it was just a couple weeks ago that I told the story about when I first went to a religious school, and that was in the seventh grade. And, you know, I chose Lutheran for myself. But, you know, now as a grown woman, to sit there and say, what the hell are you talking about? The Catholic Church owns me. Are you high? I mean, I never even went inside one of their buildings. But anyhow, seventh grade, they used to pick on this girl that had been going to school with them ever since kindergarten. She was real tiny and skinny. And she had a twin brother. They didn't mess with him much. And they would take her and they would throw her in a sewer that was about 6 feet deep. It was behind bushes.
Yeah.
By where the church was. And so the running joke was when we came in for recess, the teacher would always ask, well, you know, where is so-and-so? And of course I was traumatized because coming from a life of being targeted and persecuted, it seemed natural that my first year there, I was persecuted because an eighth grade boy liked me, so I became a whore and a slut. Now, my friend in the sewer would cry up to me and she'd say, you know, Susie, please get me out of here. And like I said on that show, what could a 13-year-old girl do up against a bunch of punk-ass rich kids that, you know, half of the day they were working their ritual and the other half they were abusing and throwing people in the box. So believe me, the only reason I enjoyed school personally, Randy, because my home life was so dark. And of course, all the great people that loved me and were there for me, you know, that since we run together, I mean, they knew me and they took care of me at a time before I knew who they were. I just knew they were love. And I didn't find those people in the school system, oddly enough. But my story is a little reversed. I think when you come from more of a what's considered to be a normal middle class family where everything looks right, I didn't have that experience. I really can't speak to it. I came from the other side of the tracks, and I think that's why, as we go into my life chart a little later, that we'll see how my maiden name of Glasscock was actually wiped off the census records in the mid-1800s. There's so much to think about. I think about the, you know, the family in this never-ending story with the castle, and there's the, you know, the wicked sibling that gets rid of the other ones and they're ostracized and off they go into exile. I think that many of us have been in exile. And like you said, I mean, it's conscious. I chose this and I'm thrilled to get to, like I said, work through it with somebody like you that has so much experience in these matters. I really appreciate it.
Well, if you just look at that whole social incubator you're thrown into, you see the metaphor behind throwing a little girl down a sewer. You see, that's a form of torture. It's no different than locking a child up in a room. It's no different than splitting somebody's conscious mind using electrical devices or psychotropic drugs or any of the other methods that the black scientists came up with. The social incubator was put there, and there were agents injected into it. Think Agent Smith from The Matrix here. Think about them operating to psychologically test you and split you in some way. And permissibly, the institutions allow this to a certain degree or another. They don't like it when people get mortally wounded, but they don't mind the psychological abuse that goes on at every level, from the peer level to the level of the adults who are supposed to be there to oversee the souls of these people, you know, the souls of the students in the school, the souls of the children inside the church. Whatever the institution is, we accept a fair amount of psychopathic behavior inside of any crowd of people. And it's actually designed that way. If you look at peer grouping and you look at how people congregate together, you know, look at the high school football stadium, the metaphor behind that, the metaphor behind sports and competitive endeavors, and one's better than another. And the pecking order is socially, whether it's economic, sexual, or social, there's a certain pecking order that's established that's designed to raise one person up and to make another person less than. All of that is a social incubator that's constantly testing and pushing against the individual's soul and psyche to see where they fit in the stratum. And there are people like, there are people like you, people like me, who are viruses inside of that because we defied the odds.
Right, exactly. And something that I, in a way, it's just a little bit of backtracking, but I'm feeling that I need to go back. You remember, of course, when our brother Christ was here on the planet, and we have the story of Golgotha, however anyone wants to interpret that, which would be his passion, suffering, crucifixion, and such.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But isn't it amazing that it seems like after that time, you know, they made up some kind of whitewash bullshit rule that from now on there would be no blood sacrifices. There would be no pedophilia or abuses of whatever creepy thing that is. And so all these years we have humans actually believing that, say, they would never commit that kind of a blood ritual in this modern day because we're not barbarians. But as we know now, there's as much of it now as there was then. And then in the middle place, they collected the blood just through the acts of war.
Yeah, they collected the blood, they collected the energy. They basically harvested louche from the activities of war and predatory behavior. But, all these big institutions.
Right. And like you said, we're different. So the way I consider myself as a system buster, that I chose to come in to a very dark reality so I would choose light at the appropriate time. And that played well for me. So I know you're going to have a good story for this, and this is not going to be a hard question, I promise. So here you are. Oh, but wait, you got to show your picture from high school because I need a story for that before we hit our next place. So bring up.
Okay. Well, the backstory to this is you had asked me to pick out some key life points and use photography to do this. And as I pointed out, I don't really have a big trove of pictures to pull from, but I had a couple. So, okay, let's go with this one first. Let me see if I can pull this up. Sorry, this requires me to... Okay, let's see if this works.
Hey, remember, I couldn't even get a camera right.
Okay, so this is 14 years old. And this picture has actually been on my Facebook page for years. And what I said when I posted this is I found this picture while I was cleaning out my parents' house. And so this is 14 years old. When I looked at the picture, I felt like I was looking at another person. And then I felt like I was looking at me, like I was looking at somebody else and seeing something there that was very deep and kind of dark and sad and angry. So that was kind of the story of that picture. It was 14. There was, you know, a lot of stuff going on at that point in time. And it was obviously, it's a difficult period. Anytime you're going through puberty, and all of the changes. So that's kind of the first picture that we're going to focus on there.
You look very mature there. Your eyes, the way your sideburns were already coming in. I mean, you know, usually most guys at 14 still look like little boys. You look like a young man. I'm sure even that sets you apart.
Well, I don't even know how to comment on that. I have no objective observation on that. I was looking at it from a kind of a psychological profile. Okay, so did you want this other picture as well?
Oh, I do.
Okay. So let's do this. We'll pull this back up, and we'll go to let's see, this was senior year, high school, editing the yearbook, high school yearbook. The interesting thing about this picture is, and there's reasons why I chose these. If you look at my eyes there, you see the dark lines under them? That was not a bad night's sleep. That was about 2 months after I had hurled my tiny little Renault car head-on into a tractor trailer in a rainstorm and survived. So that was basically the healing of the trauma around the eyes at that point. I couldn't find the other pictures. I have pictures of the stitches that were in my head and stuff. That accident was a miracle. I was told by the state police that investigated there was no way anybody could have even survived this accident. It was a tiny little French car that I hydroplaned on a two-lane road driving to school, and the car went head-on into the tractor trailer. I remember seeing the truck coming at me. So that picture was kind of, like I said, that's a few months later. I was still kind of coming through the trauma, and some people would say I never really recovered. But
all right, now can I ask you a couple of questions about that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, because in my experience, what you survived there was one of your five exit points. And so, you know, there's so many people that say, oh, if it's your time, it's your time, and blah, blah, blah. But if you have a higher purpose, the way that I've read it in the history is that the angels are allowed to intercede and protect you. So with that being said, do you remember, as you were seeing that image, how time slowed down and you were delivered to a different place, almost beyond it?
Yeah, no, that's actually the exact memory I have. And I've relived it a number of times. And I've often wondered, you know, I shared with a metaphysical group I used to meet with a few years ago, mm-hmm. that I believe on one timeline I did not survive that accident. I also believe that something pulled me from it because I have no explanation for how I survived it. I mean, they found me on the side of the road, unconscious. And there's no explanation for how I was ejected from a car that was being crumpled like an accordion into the front end of a Mack truck. You know, there are no explanations for this logically. The police told me that I had, you know, some lady in church that told my mother that I was obviously saved for a specific purpose, whatever that means. But, you know, I would rate it as a miracle having survived that.
When that happened to me, it was when I first moved down here to Ferguson, and I was getting on Highway 70 to go down to the city. And ironically enough, you know that song, In the Arms of the Angel, Fly Away? Right. So when I get on the highway and I just start moving, and I wasn't much farther than two exits down, I was right by my high school, all of a sudden there was a line of red lights in front of me, although there had been no cars to the side of me as I was driving. And then, all of a sudden, myself and my vehicle were propelled over those red lights. And when I turned around and looked back, there was an explosion. And that was some kind of a car, you know, in my rational mind, that had smashed into something. But yeah, I've definitely experienced that, and it's actually happened to me three times on the road over 52 years. And I've always told people that I know that I've seen all my exit points very easy.
When you say an exit point, exactly what do you mean the exit point in terms of departing out of this present life?
Or let's even modify that to say present reality.
Yeah. You see, because what we're talking about, these are experiences that get reported a lot by people who have interactions with extraterrestrials, whether it's an abduction or a contact experience. There's something about time that seems to be lapsed. You know, it's the missing time phenomenon, but there's something else more to it. I think it has to do with the dimensional aspects of entering into something that is on a different scalar level temporally, so that time gets suspended, it gets contracted, it can be expanded, it can be compressed. We're biologically synchronized to this particular time-space coordinate that we're in. You know, our heart beats, 180 beats per minute. Our blood pulses. We breathe rhythmically. All of the things that we do operate in concert with a specific rhythm that's part of the reality stream. But when we step out of that even briefly, what we discover is another reality where we kind of like almost remodulate. So a lot of this has to do with perception of reality and perception of other realities where we are now faced with things that don't fit standard models.
Right. So when you were in that experience that we see in the picture, and we see the wire under the eyes, and we take into consideration what you just spoke about, a part of you dying metaphorically, while this person that I love and know is alive, okay? So you come to 21, and at that age, your spirit comes to the forefront of the experience and asks the soul, will you continue to learn and grow, or do you know it all? So, obviously, you had a profound experience there because you're a student of life. So tell us.
Yeah. You know, the concept of the 21 thing, I tried to think back on that a little bit, and I don't... Okay. It's funny how we have gaps in our memory about things. I was in transition at the point where that picture was taken. The automobile accident and what happened after that was part of a whole evolutionary experience that I was not the same person anymore. I mean, effectively, somebody else could have walked in at this point. Another concept that you play with.
Walk-ins.
Mm-hmm. I've talked to people who are walk-ins, and I know people who are walk-ins. It's an exotic concept, but basically, it's not that far afield. But I guess what I'm saying is that I looked at life differently at that point. I was more reverent after that event. I was more circumspect about my life. I think I was a little less reckless, which in a way is kind of a shame because it's a lot of things I enjoyed doing that were reckless. But I continue to do that too. I mean, God knows how many mountains I skied off of and smashed myself and my skis up. That accident wasn't my last accident. It certainly wasn't the end of, taking risks with things. But I would say that spiritually, I was a very different person.
Well, yeah. Surely, you were in college at that time, right? At 21?
I didn't go to college.
See, now, there's something that we haven't...
At least not for any period of time, very briefly.
You know what happens when you make an assumption and all of a sudden you're like, damn, an ass of you and me. I would have surely figured that you did do the college experience, bless your heart. I'm so glad to hear that you didn't.
Didn't fit. It wasn't a fit. It wasn't what I wanted to do.
But no one.
It was actually a cause of a lot of stress because my parents, everything about them was preparing me to go off to college and then become some, I don't know.
Take me to a story then with your parents giving you shit about not going to college. And what you said to them.
Well, basically, I left home when I was 19.
There it is.
And other kids were going to college, I left. You know, I worked, I had jobs, and I always found a way to make a pretty good living, frankly. I mean, I've never been actually poor, even at that age. Relatively speaking, there wasn't a problem. But more than anything else, I'm an autodidact. You know, why would I go off to college and be taught by professors when I was far more curious about things that they were never going to be able to teach me?
Right.
Some of that goes into the experiences I had spiritually, the paranormal stuff, and even, you know, some of the, let's just say, chemically induced experiences that I participated in as a teenager. That's not everybody's background, but it was mine.
Right.
And, you know, it wasn't recreational. But there was a component to this where it was the inner searching. The wanting to know what goes on in the inner world. And I don't hide that from people. I don't hide it from my kids. That's just a part of my experience and who I am.
Right.
So there wasn't a lot to be gained there. There was a lot of pressure, obviously, by the parents. And yet at the same time, there was this pressure to grow up real fast. In fact, I feel like that was my greatest pressure. I was the oldest child. And it was made known to me that, you know, you're going to make way for your brothers. So I did. You know, I went off and created my own life, which is what everybody ultimately has to do anyway.
I just love that story. I really do. And the other thing I love about that is that you were honest with your children the entire way through. And that's another place of the heart that we share. And you know, people in the box yearn for that. They want to be close to their children, and they wish they could tell them those things. But as you and I know, sometimes those things are hard for our children to hear. And back to the whole story, our purpose here is to know ourselves, and then we can go on to help the others. So, bravo.
So having said that, though, I will say that it's not like I stopped getting an education. I took courses. I also, at the point where technology emerged, was very gifted with technology. I mean, even as a kid, I tore down electronics, rebuilt electronics, created devices. And when computers hit, I felt like my world finally arrived.
Were you in your 20s during those years, like the karma free years, which would be 21?
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And that was when the computers hit and I began to learn programming. And as the computer revolution came in, I just grabbed a hold of it and rode the whole thing. And it was marvelous. I have said, and it's in my biography on the website, that I was probably an early indigo, and I'm very comfortable with technology, and I felt like the technology was something I knew from a long time ago. It never felt foreign and alien to me. The concept of, programming languages and the overall internal structure of computers, and even this concept of this internet thing, which was to come later, I distinctly remember having a vision in early 1980 of sitting on a beach trading stocks with a computer-like device. Lo and behold, by the time we get to 30 years later, what are people doing? They're sitting on the beach with mobile devices and they're trading stocks, they're doing financial transactions, they're on Skype, they're on Twitter, they're on Facebook. You know, I suspect that that was part of what was put into me either as a child or even pre-incarnation. It's just this comfort with this.
Yes, yes, yes. I completely agree. That would be, in my world, the idea of knowing that this day would come that we are experiencing now. And as a child, every indicator of it was there. So whether it was a comfort or a terror back then, it's hard to say with the program in place. But with the program gone, I'm going to have to say that it has definitely been a comfort. I feel so much better now, knowing that all this was for a higher purpose instead of the people that get trapped in the boo-hoo story and feel it's some way their fault.
Well, it is all, and it's a course that we mapped out, and we have the ability to dynamically change it as we go, too. I mean, you know, you can talk about all the shitty things that happened to you, and there is some of that. I mean, again, you know, I don't think any of us came in thinking we were going to inflict grievous harm on ourselves, but we did map a life course that included some of this. And it is all part of a learning process that we go through. They're actually on the grand cosmic scale, and some people will really reject this hard. There really are no victims.
Right.
The soul seeks the arc of the soul and goes where it goes. And that can include some pretty horrendous things that I don't think humanly we completely understand. That's something I've struggled with for years.
My buddy, Mr. Vic, one day we were in a conversation about that, and he had brought up that somehow, say, the children in the third world countries were conscious that they were going to choose that experience to suffer and starve and blah, blah, blah. But I think that really, that's not it at all, that they see the bigger picture of the suffering and say, okay, I'm invincible, I can do it, instead of the particulars and the details, because those would be the things that would make anybody run and not want to learn, not want to see it.
So. Yeah, we struggle with that, and justifiably so, because if you look at the world around us, you know, there's so many horrendous things that are going on. We sort of tend to cast things as victims and people as perpetrators. And like I said, the goal of what we're doing ultimately is the healing of all of that, the bridging the gap back between the perpetrator and the victim, the wounded and the healer, and restoring the generations back into the symmetry of the one. And that's not just spiritual. I'm not trying to put this in like some spiritual mishmash thing. These are concepts that I've struggled with my whole life that I think people have to struggle with as well. And you cannot agree with that. I get that completely. But I think that once you experience enough in life, and once you begin to look at this thing from a spiritual perspective, you have to at least entertain the idea that we need to heal this thing for the good of all.
Absolutely. And so that's a perfect intro then into the crisis years that happened between 30 and 33. And that's associated with the mission and the work. So do you have a story about an experience when you were that age that came to really challenge you?
You know, I actually don't. That probably somewhat breaks the pattern.
Well, mine was health related. It wasn't mentally. It wasn't a mental thing. It was the health thing with me. Did you have anything like that? Maybe minor surgery, a change in your physiology.
No.
Well, you know,
I couldn't break the mold on that one, I think. I think 30 to 33, mainly because that was the point at which I was starting a family. I didn't start a family until I was 30. So I had a very long singlehood. I basically was a teenager until I was 29.
Wow.
And I lived like that, you know, minus some of the, you know, obviously more immature aspects. But yeah, I mean, that was not a crisis period of time for me at all, Suz.
Well, how did you meet your lady love? Tell me that.
Wow, that's,
Should I skip that one?
Yeah, let's skip that one. That's kind of personal.
You got it. Oh, yeah. No. And believe me, that's fine, because you made me realize something today, and that I'm a brutal questioner, and I never...
No, and I don't mean that.
Like that.
Nothing's off of the, off the charts. I just may not answer everything.
Well, and that is absolutely, you're right. And I feel the same way about things. So that's fine. It's just, we're going through the story. Okay.
Yeah. So
what do you got for me in your angel years, which would be your 40s? And so we're burning out throes. We are coming into a maybe a more interactive relationship with the spirit world, some people say. I mean, do you have something you'd like to share there?
Interesting. You know, actually, those years were kind of building years. I was in the business world at that point in time.
What did you do?
Numerous things. I had numerous careers. I owned a business. I worked as a consultant. I was in sales. But those were building years for me. And I may not be typical of this, you know, the patterns, but the 40s, the age 40s, those were years of raising children and household and all the things that I think a lot of people were probably doing in their 30s.
Right.
So not a lot of crisis. I mean, there was some, yeah.
I believe surely during that phase, though, that all the business transactions you were doing, you were always striving to be moral and ethical.
Yeah, well, that was part of the struggle. Part of the struggle was that I didn't do real well in certain things because I just wasn't a predator.
Right.
Corporate sales is not the place to be if you have a conscience.
Exactly.
I actually found a lot more comfortable to be behind the scenes of things, but that's not where money was made. So corporate America was kind of, and I say that on scale because I was dealing with corporations. There was huge balancing of conscience in terms of some of the things that, you know, I was doing at that time. And in order to be successful, you have to be aggressive, which means you have to be manipulative. And I found I wasn't very good at that. I was good at persuasion. That was my saving grace. You know, the people who valued somebody that would look them in the eye and tell them the truth about something, that was good. But, you know, there were a lot of people who just wanted to, you know, pull bullshit and as many lies as possible just to get a signed contract. No, it's not going to work with me.
I would believe that and agree fully. And that's why I never fit into a structure of work other than being self-employed. So I completely understand that. We have been on and on and on. We have 28 minutes left. So I'm going to hit you with a couple quick things.
Okay.
And then I want you to help me with mine.
Okay.
So, all right. 49, we come to a place where either we are initiated into a year of what they call the priesthood, or that's when our decline happens, and obviously that did not happen to you, because your 50s turn out to be a place of more creation and more projects and more moral and ethical works that help people and bring them together. So, you have a story at that age that you feel like is relevant to the show?
I actually did become a priest, sort of. I was spent a fair amount of time studying theology, went to Bible school for a year, and was ordained as a Christian minister, which lasted about 18 months, interestingly enough, and then that blew up. Mainly because I theologically don't line up with anybody. I wanted to help people, and I found the same things in the church that I found in the corporations when I found out that churches were corporations. That was really the turning of the tide when I realized that basically, you know, churches operated as businesses. And when I saw the behind the scenes details of that, I left. And that was the beginning of the threshing floor. That was me going out and going, okay, I can't do this anywhere else. There were a series of circumstances that actually happened here that are very interesting. While I was still in the church, I was actually on AM radio here on the East Coast of the United States on a radio station that was 30,000 watts. And the reason why it was 30,000 watts, if you don't know much about radio transmitters, 30,000 watts, 50,000 is kind of considered the big guys. This was a radio station that was licensed as a stereo AM radio station in the late 70s. Stereo AM never caught on. Well, the truth of the matter is this station was licensed to broadcast at 30,000 watts. So they put the two signals together and they blasted the signal out at 30,000 watts. So I wound up on a radio station that was hitting five states. And I was producing my own shows. I was doing engineering and producing on the station. And as the internet came in 2003, I received an email from a man named James Lloyd, who lives in Oregon and runs a network on shortwave radio. And he says, do you have any radio experience? And so we got to talking and I wound up going on to shortwave radio. Interestingly enough, at times intersecting people like Alex Jones and numerous other illuminaries of broadcast. Hello there. Down, boy, down. Sorry, I mentioned Alex Jones and dogs bark. Isn't that amazing?
It's not a cat playing piano. It's Joe coming home. Our pit bull boobs.
I thought maybe it was Alex Jones. Never mind. Anyway, so I wind up on shortwave radio. I wind up at the same time trying to figure out how in the hell to take these shows that I'm doing, record them, and put them out for people. And I'm going, you know, the best thing to do here is put up a website. So I put up a website, and I'm going, so I learned a little bit about how to manage and manipulate audio files in my background when I was in broadcast. So I started putting up these files, which at the time were real audio files. This was back in the day before the MP3. And about 10 months later, lo and behold, I'm doing what's called a podcast. 2003, 2004, the RSS feed comes into the internet and we wind up being among some of the first podcasters. So that was the beginning of what eventually became the thing that we're really doing right now. We just kind of evolved the whole thing. You know, podcasts became this expanded format and it became radio shows and then streaming radio shows. And then one day, we wind up, we're doing videos and YouTube emerges. And the next thing you know, here we are, we're on Conscious Consumer Network doing a TV show. So there was like, you know, whole decade and a half blew by of just playing and having fun with technology while at the same time having a spiritual experience.
And I think that's lovely because the year 2004 is the year I tag when it comes to Rudolf Steiner entering my life. So Every year is important. I really appreciate you going through that process today. No one has done that with me yet.
Mm-hmm.
Namaste. Now, you know, like I had shared with you, my whole life I was told I was paranoid, I was nuts, don't talk about it, shut up. And you know, of course, I went the other way. And here I come up with ways to life chart that are way beyond what we see here in the standard chart that's in the Human Life by George and Gisela O'Neill. And since the last show, all my life charting stuff is all nice and neat in this container. You remember the last time we were together, the paper was all over the floor. It was shortly thereafter that I got that together. Now, it wasn't but, I guess, about 5 days ago that I came up with a new way to life chart. So, real quick, you know, the charts I do have, Randy, we have the ones that are in like chronological order or timelines. We have specific storylines, like, which is what we did with you today. We have, I never call it a negative, so it's a plus and a minus chart that would look at the different difficulties as potentiated energy for the future that we could build on. We have the four categories, which would be the ego patterns, the interest studies, the friends and family, and the places, jobs, mission. So what this tripped out chart is what I'm imagining calling a spiral chart. And I don't know that it would be easy for someone to do that came from a huge family, because I'm a very small family. And so around this circle would be every family member involved. And then of course, what kind of blew my mind is it was a few years ago that I learned about my mother's father, my grandfather, that was the managing editor of the Custard Combat Tier. He was also my grandfather that passed in 1952 when my mother was 8. This is where the MK Ultra thing, it came in for me the first time. And then when I combined it with the kin on my father's side, which of course, you know, my maiden name was Glasscock. If I go back as far as I can go, they go to a Dr. George Glasscock, who was a med tech in the Revolutionary War and allowed his property to be host to the troops. And he did a lot of great work there. And in 1787, he was murdered by an aristocrat by the name of Philip Alston. And when I say that, I mean it was Philip Alston that instigated his slave Dave to murder my grandpa Glasscock. And surely Philip Alston was chastised, but of course we come to find out in other periodicals and books that it's very possible that he escaped and became this guy that went up and down the river and prostituted everything and wound up living and escaping. So with all that being said, what happened with this, Randy, as I was putting it together, on the bottom, I connect the Glasscock name being related to George Washington, and that is through his mother's side. And I find that interesting because, say, as a Glasscock, I'm not in the Glasscock families since the Civil War, because this was compiled in 1993, and I gave that name up in 1987 when I married my ex. So, you see, I've always been on the down low or off the maps this entire time, first with no computer footprint, and secondly, being from a lineage that was pretty much wiped out. So, as I went around this wheel, I came up with some pretty fascinating and almost pretty like right in your face proof that I have definitely been a targeted individual my entire existence, and I know that goes even before this lifetime, surely. And
you know,
and you know that I believe I know who I am already, but I surely wouldn't go out there spitting it out because people would find me insane or arrogant. So we're just laying groundwork, I think, for all of us, and that's why we need the ego out of it. It's like after Shakespeare, we're actors on a stage. So come to find out, my Uncle Charlie, who was married to my Aunt Edna, and this is the cute little girl that's holding the bear cub, just to give you an idea of her power and strength. His last name was Bauer. B-A-U-E-R. And then, of course, it was easy for me to discover that that is one of the names that goes with the Rothschild lineage and kin. Now, like I told you, my mother was definitely a victim of MKUltra, without a doubt. She fits all the checks, which would be someone with a fractured personality. I knew her to have five of them. I understand on a spiritual level that it was easy to consider her to be a transcendental medium, which would be someone that would contract with the Archons prior to incarnation, would allow them to ride on her and act through her. And of course, now I come full cycle and see why it was so easy for her to initiate the things that happened to me, because like I said, she was a mind control victim, and there must have been a trigger word or maybe even a trigger emotion like love or bonding that would set her off. And the reason I bring that up is because as cool as my Uncle Charlie was, he never really said more than a dozen words to me. And since my mother had lost her father, my Aunt Edna and Uncle Charlie became her surrogate parents. So they were very, very bonded to my mother. My mother also, he almost even felt like she was in line for their property.
Mm-hmm.
That invested. So what's really wild as I go around this wheel, because this would be my grandparents, their parents. We move around to my great aunt and uncle, and now we're seeing that the people that gave me the angel, we go back to that story, they live right here in Ferguson, right down the street from where I'm at now. Also, my dad's brother and his family lived here in Ferguson for over 50 years. And you know how I feel about Ferguson and how I feel about the third cosmic ray. And like I told you, Joe and I were destined to come together because we had one good fight left in us. And we got to experience a lot of love and a lot of blessings. But we have a purpose here. So as I go across the wheel, interestingly enough, another one of these Illuminati names popped up, which was Russell. And that's no kin to me, but in a way, I believe that he was a handler. He was my softball coach from the time that I started pitching a ball back in second grade through sixth grade. And oddly enough, my mom was kind of in love with him. You know, it was kind of creepy. He was this itty-bitty little tiny skinny Italian dude. And my mom was like a linebacker. You know, she looked like a dude, but she was always with him. And, you know, I was so rebellious, Randy, that we're going back to my earliest time now where I was naturally talented. And so he would always bug me that I should pitch faster. I was very accurate. I could hit that glove and every pitch would be a strike, but it wasn't fast enough for him. And then as I grew up, it continued with my next softball coach that gave me a lot of trouble because I would not throw my shoulder out to pitch a windmill. I refused. And I'm a straight shot. I bowled like I pitched and I pitched like I bowled. And when I was given bowling lessons before softball lessons, same thing happened to me. They wanted me to be able to throw a curveball, and I couldn't, wouldn't do the trick. I mean, I don't know, you know, Joe's laughing, but it's the truth, you know? So now, yeah, I didn't get a good enough treat, that's right. So my ex-husband, O positive. So now we know reptilian brain, animal man.
Always your comment on all of that, thank you.
I was a fool and I was just looking at outer appearance and he was a good looking guy. I was young and foolish and like I told you, I was running with a psychic and that was when I had to choose because of course I couldn't be both and I tried to be normal and be a mom and fit in and make people happy, which was never gonna be. So my ex's mom's middle name is another Illuminati name by the name of Collins. And when we had our phone conversation, your ears perked up on that Collins name, but I don't know nothing about it. Could you elaborate to me on the Collins?
Okay. Yeah, you know, since we're just kind of going through synchronicity things, two things popped up. Okay. Number one is the Collins name in connection to, you know, Dark Shadows. Remember the TV show Dark Shadows? And it was made into a really pretty horrible movie a few years ago.
It terrified. You know,
the Collins family largely being part of this group that descended out of Transylvania. It goes into vampirism.
Oh, shit.
Okay?
Yeah.
Second thing that jumped into my head was, if you know who author Nick Redfern is, Nick's a long time. He's a British writer. He now lives in the U.S. He's written, I don't know, 50 or 60 books on various paranormal subjects. I interviewed Nick in 2010, I think, again, one of my earlier interviews, when a group, no, the book was called Final Exit, and the group that he wrote about was called the Collins Elite. The Collins Elite were a group of people who basically were in possession of knowledge via the priesthood, and inside the Defense Department about UFOs and contact with non-human entities. The Collins Elite were a theological group who strongly believe that UFOs were demonic. They were inside the Reagan administration, and they were part of an agenda to prevent humanity from being taken over by negative extraterrestrials. And the group was called the Collins Elite.
All right, check this out. So, of course, the Collins name, from what I knew of it in the Pratt family, was absolutely Catholic, but they did not practice. And down the line, okay, so I married, you know, I get married to Tim, and it was easy for him to convert to being Lutheran because he had very much distaste in his mouth from Catholicism, so much so he did not even really know if he believed in God. He flipped over into studying Scientology, and I'll tell you what, that's when I knew I was getting out and I devised my plan. But I've just seen by Mel that we have 1 minute left, and
an ordinary jar of Vaseline jelly. It's something we don't think about much, except when we've got chapped lips or a small cut. But for people living in areas of crisis, simple skin conditions could turn into serious issues. So we created the Vaseline Healing Project, a partnership with
the Vaseline is not good for you guys.
Seen by Mel that we have 1 minute left, and I know there's somebody right behind us, so last thing I want to show you on my little wheel here is, oddly enough, the Glasscocks that lived here in Ferguson their entire lives, pretty much. My cousin Steve lived in the same building where I lived and worked, which was the Pope building. And you know my slumlord's last name was Pope. And the other slumlord here in Ferguson, his last name is Hearst. H-E-A-R-S-T. How about that?
I think that's grist for a mill and another show, Suz.
So then you're telling me you will come back on my show and we'll spend more time?
Yeah, we got a lot more. We got a lot more things we need to kick around here. So yeah, we'll do that.
I'm so happy to hear that, Randy, because, you know, sometimes I try to cram too much in my shows, and, you know, but I want to keep people interested too. And of course my brain,
every show is a sequel.
Yes, it is. And it builds on this NeverEnding Story. So, I guess I should really say goodbye today, but it's never goodbye. It's just, we go on our ways for now.
It is. It is. Namaste.
Oh, namaste. And I want to thank everyone that watched today. And
I always, always appreciate you guys that watch and take interest in what we're doing here at the NeverEnding Story. Not just only on Sophia's Emporium, but everywhere as we go direct. So, Randy, I appreciate you so much, and it's always good seeing you. For anyone that has interest, the Glasscock since the Civil War is actually a document, as well as the Glasscock family. So, like I said, I know who I am. Randy knows who he is. A lot of people know who they are. It's just time to speak up and deal with it. So, I hope that we all are okay with this as it goes forward. So thanks again. Peace, love, and light. We'll talk soon. Namaste.